Good evening. Welcome to New Avenue G Church of Christ here in Temple, Texas, a Bible adult Bible class. This morning, we're going to still be talking about Paul and his decision to make an appeal before Caesar. We are now in Acts 25, and the verses that we're going to be talking about are going to be 1 through 12. Now, we know that Paul has made a request to go see a Caesar. And, you know, Caesar, I've come to learn that it's not really a name any longer. It's now a title. You had Julius Caesar, who was the beginning, then you had Tiberius Caesar and Augustus Caesar and Claudius Caesar. Now Caesar, the name, has become the title, and it's just like a pharaoh. Well, some of the things that we're going to be talking about are going to be the new governor that Paul has to appear for at this time. And we're going to be talking about the governor's first act that he does. And then we're going to be talking about those scheming Jews. And then, of course, now he's got to go through another trial. Paul's been through about 2 or 3 trials, but now he's going through another one with this new governor. And at the end of this trial, Paul makes a special request. Our key scripture that was chosen, the scriptures, are going to be from 1 Peter, the 2nd chapter, verses 13 through 15. And they read, "Therefore, submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good, you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men." Before we start our lesson, let us pray together. Dear God, our Father, listen to what your servants have to say and take heed to our requests. Preserve our lives, for we put our trust in none other than you, Lord. We ask for your mercy and your grace. Lift us up, Lord. Forgive us of our iniquities. Your steadfast and abounding love we look for every day. All we ask for you is to lend your ear to our pleas. For we're being smothered, God, by the evil of this world that we live in. We know that you will answer in some way. So give us the patience to wait upon you and the vision to see the majesty and power of our Most High God. There is no other like you. There was none before you, and there will be none that will follow you. No one can perform the wonders that you are capable of doing. You are great, Father. Ensure that we are taught the correct way so that we may walk in your truth. We give our whole heart and our steadfast love to you, Father. Give us the strength and the courage to stand true and to let none dissuade us against you. Take us under your wing. You are our fortress. You are our protection forever. We love you, and we will do all we can to proclaim the gospel to the world. In the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus, we do pray. Amen. I want you to look at two short videos having to do with an appeal. Appeals aren't that much different today than from what they were a long time ago. But listen to this.
In this video, we will discuss appeals in civil litigation. Generally speaking, an appeal is where a party that lost on one or more claims argues that the trial court judge made a mistake. First, let's talk about when and where there can be an appeal. When can a party appeal? Usually after the case is over, when there's a final judgment. In unusual circumstances, a party might be able to appeal a judge's decision before a case ends. Where does a party appeal? Usually in a federal or state appellate court. In the federal court system, the appellate courts are known as circuit courts of appeals. And these circuit courts are generally organized by geography. So what's an appeal? On an appeal, the losing party is really not focusing on what the jury did. The losing party is focusing on a mistake made by the trial court judge. For example, the losing party could argue that the judge incorrectly defined the law for the jury. The appeal is not heard by a jury. Instead, at the appellate level, there's usually a panel of at least three judges. And the lawyer for the losing party will argue to the panel that the trial court judge committed legal errors. If you'd like to discuss appeals or any other matter related to U.S. law, stop by the message board and please visit my blog.
Okay, this is another one, but it's a little bit longer, and we won't see the whole thing, but it goes into it a little bit in depth, but we won't look at the whole thing.
I'm Aaron Lanigan with Lanigan & Lanigan, attorneys in Winter Park, Florida. I want to talk for a minute about the appellate process. Most people, you know, when you watch courtroom drama on TV, it's always at the trial level. The witnesses are on the witness stand, the jury's there. Who wants to watch a TV show about somebody making a legal argument in front of a panel of older judges? That's what an appeal is. An appeal is essentially nothing more than, I think this trial judge made a mistake. Remember, trial judges are just lawyers who decided they'd like to be a judge. Sometimes they were good lawyers. Sometimes they're not good lawyers. Sometimes they're experienced lawyers. Sometimes they're lawyers who have almost no experience. So there's nothing infallible about a judge, and most judges will candidly tell you that they're just another lawyer trying to do his job. So an appeal is when you have a situation where you think the judge has ruled incorrectly. If you go to the law library, there are literally thousands of books of cases, and every one of those is an appeal. So there's plenty of cases being appealed. There's plenty of situations where somebody believes fervently that the judge has made a mistake. And when he has, it should be appealed. One of the problems with appeals is they're expensive. As most things in law are today, there's nothing cheap about doing an appeal, especially if you are not the lawyer who handled the case at the trial level, because not only are you going to do all the research and prepare the briefs, but you've got to go back and study the case to determine what happened leading up to the appeal. So it's an expensive proposition. What kinds of cases are appealed? All kinds of cases are appealed. There are different types of appeals. There used to be what we called interlocutory appeals. And that was essentially anytime a judge made a ruling that you didn't like, you could file an appeal. If it was not the end of the case, it was an appeal along the way. For instance, let's say an attorney filed a request to get certain documents from the other side, and they objected, and the judge ruled, no, you're not entitled to those documents, and you think that the judge is wrong, that you are. That would be an appeal, but it's not the end of the case. It's just an appeal of one of the issues along the way. And in the old days, you would file what we called an interlocutory appeal and get those things decided. Well, the courts were flooded with interlocutory appeals. And many years ago, back when I was a kid, they changed a lot of the appellate rules, and they kind of did away with interlocutory appeals.
Okay, that pretty much covered about what an appeal is about. And appeals haven't really changed that much. The one difference in the appeal that Paul make, which they mentioned in the first video, was that the court or the governor hadn't even made a decision about what he was being trialed about. You know, his judgment hadn't been put down. Before he had gotten a verdict, he wanted to go see Caesar. And that's where we're at now. And we're going to be reading Acts 25, verses 1 through 12. Now, when Festus had come to the province, after 3 days, he went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem. Then the high priest and the chief men of the Jews informed him against Paul, and they petitioned him, asking a favor against him, that he would summon him to Jerusalem while they lay in ambush along the road to kill him. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept in Caesarea, and that he himself was going there shortly. Therefore, he said, let those who have authority among you go down with me and accuse this man. So if there is any fault in him, to see if there's any fault in him. And when he had remained among them more than 10 days, he went down to Caesarea. And the next day, sitting on the judgment seat, he commanded Paul to be brought. When he had come, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood about and laid many serious complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. But he answered for himself, he neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I offended in anything at all. But Festus, wanting to do the Jews a favor, answered Paul and said, are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and there be judged before me concerning these things? So Paul said, I stand at Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews I have done no wrong, as you very well know. For if I am an offender, or have committed anything deserving of death, I do not object to dying. But if there is nothing in these things of which these men accuse me, no one can deliver me to them. I appeal to Caesar. Then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, you have appealed to Caesar? To Caesar you shall go. Now, we're going to go and look at them first by verse or a couple of verses at a time. I wanted to mention about Caesar and the name. You know, I was wondering where that name come from and how it, you know, but the name Caesar, some say it came from some type of animal that they had somewhere, I believe, over in Egypt or Africa. And others say it had something to do with his hair. I remember getting that Caesar haircut. Then others say it was because of the way that he was born. When you talk about a Caesarean birth, that's where that came from. Caesar, supposedly, when Julius Caesar was born, his mother had to be cut in order for him to be born. Okay, Acts 25, verses 1 through 12. Now, when Festus had come to the province, after 3 days, he went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem. Porcius Festus now takes over for Felix. Or Felix, you know, well, Felix had been lost his position because of the things that he had done. And I think we're going to mention that here. I think we did mention it last week about how he had, there was some unruliness going on in Caesarea. And Felix slaughtered a lot of the Jews, and the Jews with their influence and their religious power had Felix removed. Now, Felix may have been a better man Festus may have been a better man than Felix. You know, he may have been more honest, but Felix had more experience than Festus. Festus was just kind of incompetent. He wasn't a very good governor. And he was definitely not a better governor than Felix was. Felix had the experience. He had been there for a couple of years. And you know, Festus wasn't aware of the schemes about the Jews, and I guess he didn't know how slick they were and how they were plotting and stuff. But Festus wanted to get some popularity, so he kept Paul in prison. You know, now Caesarea was the capital of the province, but Jerusalem was about the largest city in the province. And it was the center of the religious hierarchy. Festus, the first act that he performed, he had only been there 3 days, he's going down to Jerusalem. I guess to get to know the people over who he had ruled, or those who he was going to be judging. He wasted no time in getting there. Only 3 days he was on the road. Acts 25, verses 2 and 3. Then the high priest and the chief men of the Jews informed him against Paul, and they petitioned him, asking a favor against him, that he would summon him to Jerusalem while they lay in ambush along the road to kill him. You know, the Jews brought about Felix's removal. You know, they did have power after Felix had done what he had done and had killed a bunch of the Jews when they had problems in Caesarea. Now, the Jews thought Festus would want to make friends. After all, he just got there. He would want to have somebody, he would want to be friendly with them and them to be friendly with him. Now, the request that the Jews made, it wasn't really genuine. I already mentioned the Jews were some scheming individuals. And you think, hey, these are supposed to be men of God. But they were scheming, they were liars, they would cheat. They were trying to influence Festus. You know, they wanted him to prejudge Paul even before they had even had even before he had a chance to go and see Paul. Before he even had a trial. But like I said, they were just scheming. They weren't for real. They said they wanted Paul to be sent to Jerusalem. What they were actually doing, they were planning on killing Paul on his way to Jerusalem. They didn't even want him to have a trial because they knew it would come out just like it did before. You know, but Festus was naive about the plan to kill Paul on the field. He probably didn't know about it. You remember when Paul was in Jerusalem, his sister's son overheard the Jews talking or plotting to kill Paul. And that's when they got the chief captain, Lysias. He went and told him. And he got 200 horsemen and 200 spearmen and 70 foot soldiers. And they were take Paul to Caesarea. And that was a large company of men now. And if Festus was gonna bring Paul to Jerusalem, not knowing this, he wouldn't probably use that amount of men. And maybe they think it would be easier for them to kill him this time. You know, but you know, Festus probably wanted to show that, hey, this I'm in charge and I'm in control, and he was going to take charge of this. He wanted to maintain the honor of his court. Acts 25, verse 4 and 5 says, but Festus answered that Paul should be kept in Caesarea and that he himself was going there shortly. Therefore, he said, let those who have authority among you go down with me and accuse this man to see if there is any fault in him. Paul was showing his authority, and he refused their request. He wasn't going along with what they had asked for. You know, in fact, it was going to be easier for him anyway, since he was going to be going there as soon as he left Jerusalem. Now, had Paul regranted the request, I'm sorry, had Festus granted the request, Paul may have been killed. Now, who was going to kill Paul? Well, if you remember from the last lesson, there were 40 men who had pledged that they wouldn't eat or sleep until Paul was dead. Now, these men had to be getting kind of hungry by now, or they done probably got out of that pledge anyway, some kind of way. But they surely would have been in the ones who would attempt to take Paul's life had he been sent to Jerusalem. Again, I mentioned that he may have had a small escort and it would have been easier. And those 40 men, the ones, they had to be plotting. It's been how many days? We know it's been at least 15 days they hadn't supposed to be eaten or drunk anything with their pledge, but you know they got out of that some kind of way. Oh, and one other thing, you know, there was no witness this time to give a warning, like I told you about the Paul's sister brother that gave warning and let them prepare for it. So how was God going to protect him? Well, you know, God was in the picture. He was going to protect Paul this way, the way he did it. His denial, having Festus deny the request of the Jews, he was protecting Paul. God doesn't always work in the same method. Last time he had a witness. Now he just had Festus denying their request. But you know what Festus had told them when they made their request? He said, let those who were in charge, those head Jews, the ones that were in charge, those who could afford to make the trip, those who were witnesses to the case, those who had health that would allow them to make the trip, let them come and go with him. Acts 25 and 6. And when he had remained among them no more than 10 days, he went down to Caesarea. And the next day, sitting on the judgment seat, he commanded Paul to be brought. Festus remained in Jerusalem for, they said 10 days. It just depends on where you read. Some say 10 days, some say 8 to 10 days, some say it was less than 10 days. When he started talking about these numbers and dates, it's a little bit of a problem, you know, because you, even when they talked about, well, we're gonna get to it about the high priest, who was high priest then, there's a little bit of differences by different people about exactly who the high priestess was at the time, even who the emperor was at the time. But we do know Nero was supposed to be emperor at this time because he was emperor between 59 and 64, and Claudius was the emperor just before him. Okay, this trip only took one day to go from Jerusalem to Caesarea. And I believe in the last session, it took them 2 days, but you got to remember, they had a whole bunch of men. They probably had to move a lot slower. And he hadn't been there no time. After he had been there, the next day, not 2 or 3 days later, but the next day, he called for Paul to be brought to him. Yeah, why did he do it so fast? What was his reasoning? Was it for justice? Every man's allowed a speedy trial, that's what we say today. Or was it just to please the Jews? It's probably just to please the Jews. Acts 25 verse 7 says, when he had come, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood about and laid many serious complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. The Jews accompanied him on his trip. That's another reason he could just do it the next day, because the Jews were there. And they stood about, they just all stood about where Paul was. And of course, Festus was on his judgment seat. And it was a large group of men. You know, the high priest was there and a lot of the leading men. And, you know, some even said Tertullus was present. You remember Tertullus, he was the orator or the lawyer that they brought with him last time when they had, Paul was before Felix. Was this large group about, that was standing about him, were they trying to intimidate Paul? They probably were. They probably were. High priest was there. Here we go now, because they, you know, Ananias supposedly was the high priest back when Paul stood before Felix. But now they say that there's a new high priest. And, you know, the Jews didn't get to pick their high priest any longer. The Romans decided who was going to be the high priest. But they say that whited wall individual believed to be already dead. And they had a new priest that was appointed by the Romans. And they brought up the charges against Paul. Now, they don't name the charges. Luke doesn't talk about them, but they're probably the same charges they had before, or maybe a little bit more with a few variations, same as before. And the same as before, the case that they had against Paul was worthless. There was no, and that I wondered about that. You know, why didn't they get out there and lie and bring false witnesses? Even though they're supposed to be men of God, but they sure could lie. They were doing things they had no business doing. But just like before, they didn't have any proof. No false witness brought before them. Don't know why they didn't lie and bring up false witnesses. Maybe they did, and they just didn't. Nobody believed them. I don't know. Acts 25, verse 8. Wow, he answered for himself. Neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I offended in any at all, in anything at all. So Paul gives his answers. He said he didn't break the law of the Jews. He didn't say anything about the law was false, the law was incorrect, the law was no good. He agreed. He said he agreed with the law and the prophets. Remember that. But he did say that the law had come to an end, but that in itself was not unlawful. Paul didn't do anything against the temple. You know, they had accused him of profaning the temple. And how did he do that? Supposedly, he brought in a Gentile. I believe the Gentile's name was Trophimus. It was a Greek, but he hadn't done it. That's what they accused him of and didn't prove it. And Paul said he didn't do anything against Caesar. What did they accuse him of? How could he do anything against sedition, insurrection, trying to overthrow the government? Paul didn't do this. You got to remember, how could he do this? He was only in the temple. He was only in Jerusalem for 5 days. How are he going to convince all the people to go ahead and have an insurrection in only in 5 days? He just didn't have enough time to be causing a riot. You know that he was in the temple when the Asian Jews accused him. And that was on the fifth day, being purified. 5 days. Acts 25, verse 9. But Festus, wanting to do the Jews a favor, answered Paul and said, are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and there be judged before me concerning these stones? Festus starting to show his true colors now. He would probably want, he desires the popularity with the Jews. He wanted to please the Jews. And then he asked Paul, he didn't tell him, he asked him to go to Jerusalem. And you might think, why didn't he just tell him you're going to Jerusalem? Well, there's a lot of problem there. You got to remember, Paul had that ace in the whole card. I don't know if, I think he knew about it. I'm not sure, but he must have. Still under his protection and judgment. He was still, when Paul, if Paul had gone to Jerusalem, he's saying, hey, you're still going to be under my protection and it's going to be my judgment. But you know what Paul said? He probably thought that, you know, Festus wouldn't stand up against those Jews, not against the temple Jews. Paul just didn't believe he would. But the Jews, we already talked about, the Jew didn't really want to have a trial. All they wanted to get Paul on the road, then on the way, while he was there, they wanted to murder him. They wanted to have the opportunity to kill that man. These guys had to be hungry, and they wanted to kill Paul. They hadn't eaten in, I don't know how many days, hadn't eaten or drank anything. The pledge, they weren't going to do that until Paul was dead. Acts 10 and 11. So Paul said, I stand at Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews, I have done no wrong, as you very well know. For if I am an offender or have committed anything deserving of death, I do not object to dying. But there is nothing in these things of which these men accuse me. No one can deliver me to them. I appeal to Caesar. Paul was a Roman citizen, knew his rights. You know, since the 5th century, it was a custom in Rome that an appeal could be made to your fellow citizens. But now the rules have kind of changed. The fellow citizens were now the emperor of Rome. After the rise of the empire, the appeal was to be made to Caesar. Paul demands his rights as a Roman citizen. He had that ace in the hole card. Charged with sedition, he should appear before Caesar. His appeal was made before a verdict was announced. You know, in most cases, like we talked about earlier, appeals were usually made after a verdict. And what I found so weird was that an appeal doesn't have anything to do with the verdict, but it's supposed to have the thing to do with the mistake that the judge made. Okay, that's rather rare with our judicial system today, with the appeal becoming before a verdict was given. But Paul saw that this was the only way. At least he thought this is the only way he's going to get out of his mess, is appeal to Caesar. He had been waiting a long time at Caesar's judgment seat. Well, what do you mean by that, at Caesar's judgment seat? Well, Felix was a representative, and Festus was a representative of Caesar. He had been at Caesar's judgment seat. Now, you got to remember, this is Festus' first case. He arrived at Caesarea, and this is his first case. And what? Surprise! His first case was appealed to Caesar. Now he got to, just like they talked about in the video, he's got to write up something to let Caesar know why what this appeal was being made about. But on the other hand, Festus didn't have to make a decision now, because he was put in a place where he was like in between a rock and a hard place. Now, why do I say that? Because if he decided to send Paul to Caesar, he would lose the popularity, he would lose the friendship of the Jews. But if he sent Paul to the Jews and they made their decision and they killed him, and then they found out that he had killed a Roman citizen, talking about the government, then he might have to face a lot of charges himself. You know, Paul said, and you got to excuse the way I spelled dying. Paul said he wasn't afraid of dying for something he did, if he had done it. But he wasn't going to be murdered for something that he did not do. Now, that really tells you why when he said he wasn't afraid of dying for something he did, he wasn't afraid of going to court. Paul believed in the government. At 1 Peter 2:30, we are to submit ourselves before our local governments. We are to obey the laws of the land that we live in. Paul wanted to obey the government, 1 Peter 2:13. Acts 25, verse 12, then Festus, when he had conferred with the council, answered, "You have appealed to Caesar, then to Caesar you shall go." Now, this council they're talking about, it wasn't the Jewish council, but these was a council that were legal advisors to the governor. And they advised him correctly, go to Caesar, let him make the appeal. Now, the appeal could have been denied, but if it had been, it was going to be some problems. Instead, he just said to Caesar, you will go. Now they say, you know, some people say they're going to send him to Nero. Nero was supposed to be the judge at this time. And everybody knows Nero was the one that burned Rome. But they say this was during his first couple of years, and he hasn't started acting crazy yet. All right, that actually ended our lesson. And I think the next lesson is going to be about Paul being sent to Rome on that ship. And I think the ship had a problem, the shipwreck. Anyway, the applications. Paul's conduct was above reproach. Although his enemies had made several serious charges against him, there was no basis for their accusations. As we seek to reach others with the gospel, we should seek to live in an upright manner. Peter told his audience to have conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. We are to be examples of children of God. We can turn off people from coming to Christ, coming to God, because of the actions that we do. The government exists as a divinely appointed institution. As such, it is authorized by God to punish the guilty and praise those who do good. Paul did not object to the government's position. If he had violated the laws of the land, he deserved to be punished. If he was innocent, he deserves justice. He did not hesitate to take advantage of the privileges his citizenship offered. Like him, we must recognize the government's place. Now we get to our questions that we have for this lesson. I believe it's 8 of them, and they should not be that difficult. The first one is, what was the name of the governor who succeeded Felix? Acts 24, verse 27. And that, of course, was Festus, Porcius Festus, really. Question number two. Where did the governor go shortly after he arrived in Caesarea? How long? He wasn't there but 3 days, and he left to go where? He left to go to Jerusalem. Number three, what did the Jews want the governor to do for them? Jews scheming, plotting, wanted to get Paul. Send Paul to Jerusalem. Where did Paul trials take place? It wasn't in Jerusalem. Only two places we talked about really was Jerusalem and Caesarea. Number five, what were the Jews unable to do at Paul's trial? The same thing they were unable to do at the other trial, and it was to prove that he was guilty of anything. Prove their charges against Paul. They couldn't do it. In what three areas did Paul declare himself to be innocent? Oh, we know that. You know, three of them. Law of the Jews, anything against the temple, or anything against Caesar. Where did the governor ask Paul if he would be willing to go? Same way. We only talked about two places in the whole chapter. I mean, the whole 12 verses. And I believe that's Caesarea and Jerusalem. To Jerusalem to be judged by the Jews, by him. But the Jews are going to be doing a lot of things trying to get him killed. To what authority did Paul appeal? So all he had to do was look at the name of the lesson. He appealed to Caesar. Remember that, you know, this is nothing new for Romans. In Rome back in the 5th century, they even had it where if you had an appeal, you can make an appeal to your fellow citizens. But now, since the Roman Empire, you made the appeal through Caesar. One more question, I believe. To what authority did Paul appeal? Oh, that was it, Caesar, that was it. That's the end. Okay, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it, I did. And we look forward to seeing you again on next week. God bless.